WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. We are positively into the summer months. I have talked about this for a long, long time. I've been growing my hair since I was listening to the Kix rock and roll band back in the 80s. But I got my rock and roll hair back, and I've told everyone who will listen that I will finally feel whole when I have a beer on the lawn at Merriweather, like I did with the Cicadas back in 87, like I've been doing my whole life. The music thing is back. I celebrated on Sunday, on Father's Day, with a Rock and Roll Hall of Famer, Rick Nielsen from Cheap Trick, brought his family. And there was incendiary what happened down at Rams Head, Annapolis, at lunchtime. But it was incredible. The last show I saw before the plague was Cheap Trick at the Warner Theater.
Nice.
The last show I saw after the plague was Cheap Trick, but the next show I'm seeing, the Baltimore Beatles, the rock and roll band, the man that saved my voice as Nasty Nestor back in the 1980s.
I remember.
Harford Road. Steve Whiteman, I love you. I love your band. I, by the way, I love the new music. I don't even know whether it's Kix or Funny Money or Steve Whiteman, but it was sent over to me, and I listened to it, and I said, that sounds like my childhood right there, man. So congratulations on making some beautiful new music.
Thank you. It's all mine. It's my first solo record ever in the history of my life. So, yeah, I'm pretty proud of it. It was just an opportunity that came with COVID. There was nothing much to do. So Jimmy Chalfant and Brad Divins. Are you familiar with Brad, who played guitar on the Kix second album, Cool Kids?
Absolutely. Hold on here. Let's see. I got Kix One. Okay. I got Midnight Dynamite. Hold on. No, I got Blow My Fuse. I got Hot Wire. Don't have that one. Sorry. You know what happened? Someone stole it out at the radio station.
That's
people used to steal my, but they didn't steal this one.
But anyway, Brad and Jimmy were just they were making cover songs and putting them on Facebook. Brad just wanted to get some experience in the studio that he was building in his house. And Jimmy just one day said, you know, Steve's sitting on a batch of songs. Why don't we get him in here and record some original music? So I took these 12 songs over to Brad, and we sat down and listened to them. And Brad says, let's do them all. So I had the opportunity, you know, to make an album for nothing, have great people to work with. I had Bob Perry playing guitar. I had Brad playing bass guitar, Jimmy playing drums. I got to play a little bit of everything. I got to play some guitar, some bass, some drums, do all the vocals. So it's my project, but I had a lot of help from good friends.
Steve, man, I don't even know where to begin with you. Let me just start at the top, and every time I watch you go shake your ass, what I think, okay? Because your ass shakes all over my timeline. Like, you don't know this. I haven't seen the band in maybe 4 years, maybe one
Game
of the
on
M3s.
You.
One of the M3s, I saw you. I'd been to Kixmas, you know, at Rams Head downtown. Yeah. I've lived downtown 18 years. Dude, I'm getting older, right? So I've seen Funny Money once or twice over the years. Been a little while. But the thing that I think everyone marvels at, and they marvel this with me. They say, you're 53. How do you look so youthful? And I'm working my Geddy Lee thing here, whatever. And I'm like, yeah, I'm trying hard on the Fountain of Youth thing, but I'm no Steve Whiteman. You know what I mean? Like,
I don't know about that.
No, dude, what you do on stage, and I'm not, this is last week. I mean, it's fans of yours, friends of mine, who see you do a private show whenever it was, last Tuesday, Wednesday night. I saw video of it. It shows up. I hear you. I see you. And it's, you're really timeless and ageless. And I got to know you a little bit when you voice coached me a little bit about warming up. And that practice that you gave me 25 years ago when I was losing my voice every day shouting on the radio,
right?
That has served you really, really well.
Right. Good to hear. Yeah. I mean, if you don't take care of it, you're going to mess it up. So that's what I instilled that into all my students. I mean, you got to stretch, you got to warm up, you got to prepare. Just like an athlete. There you go.
Is that good?
That's great.
Oh, I love when a teacher. See, I remember. I remember.
Great.
You're blushing. I made you blush. Look at that. It's a good teacher. It's a, you know, it's with, you know, and a decent student. Not, but seriously, for you to be able to do this, could you have envisioned when you were blowing my fuse? I can't believe they didn't steal Blow My Fuse. Hey, they stole the other one though. You must, you know, I don't have any cold shower here. I don't have any of this on my iPod. when you were making this music a generation ago, when I'm seeing you with my boy Pat the Man at the Shark Club in Las Vegas in 1993,
yeah,
that this would still be a vocation for you, this many, that people would want to gather at an M3 to see all of our bands of our generation, mm-hmm, that you could still be this good doing it and be proud of, because you can't do this as a baseball player and be proud,
right,
of it.
Right. Yeah, that's where one thing musicians have over athletes. We can do it into our 70s if we want to. Nobody envisions that it's going to last forever. But, you know, we're very fortunate to have the fans that we have around here because they have kept us afloat. And we did take a 9-year break. So during that whole period when the music was just flushed, you know, I just started teaching. I started Funny Money just to get out there and to continue playing. So when we decided to put it back together, we did some local shows and the fans flocked to it. So that inspires you when that many people show up, and it makes me want to get up and work out every day. It makes me want to take care of myself. It makes us all take these shows very seriously because we actually give a shit about how we look, how we sound. So that's a big part of it too.
Well, and you know, and I have a lot of pride in what I do, and especially on video now, and like, and it's there and it's captured forever. And when you're out playing, if it's a bad night, you know, I see it too, right? Everybody right. sees it. And we've all had a bad night. We've all sung flat. We've all fallen flat. We've all, you know, had an off night or whatever. But I guess for where you are at this point, what's the magic that keeps you doing this? And I'm wearing a Stone Horses shirt from my buddy John Allen, who was my childhood friend. We've been friends forever. He's one of my dearest friends. And, you know, his band.
John Well.
You know what I mean? But all of you who still do this, and paying bills is one thing, but not getting, you know, not getting rich off of it.
Right.
But putting the kind of effort into it all these years later, I mean, the passion shows through, and there's certain people that don't do it anymore, didn't want to do it anymore. What about it makes you want to do it?
I think you hit the nail on the head with passion. I mean, when you're a kid and you spend the majority of your childhood in your bedroom listening to music, listening to Casey Kasem's Top 40, recording with a little cassette player, all the new songs of the week, taking time to learn them, how to play them all on drums and on guitar, you never really lose that passion. So, and plus when you're in a band with great guys, you know, we actually genuinely love one another. We love playing together. We love getting out on the road together. So that's a big plus. Bands that hate each other and have to do it for the money, that would be horrible. I don't think I could do that. But very fortunate to be with these guys. And the fans. The fans keep coming out all over the country. They're coming out probably more now than they did back in the day.
Well, and the festival environments, yeah, and the fact that we've been locked down for a year and a half. Steve, you think of me as a sports guy, and man, it's been forever since I've had you on the show, and I'm a little embarrassed about it. I want to invite you out on the crab cake tour in Hagerstown. You don't eat crab cakes. That probably won't stop me from contacting you saying, I'm having a crab cake. You can have a cheeseburger. I get your French fries and iced tea. Yeah. But I've loved the music forever, and I, you know, I've never really talked to you about like writing these songs and back in the day and Painter's Mill and me being a kid. I've got the guys from Crack the Sky on this week. They're playing Heritage Fair. If you guys weren't at M3, I'm sure you'd be at Heritage Fair, right?
Yeah.
And it's getting out and being able to touch music right now. I saw Cheap Trick the other day. I have Stones tickets on my app. You mentioned 7-year-olds shaking their ass, Mix 77.
Yeah.
I'm sitting on tickets in Pittsburgh, and I hope that it happens in the fall, right? And
yeah,
Styx is out, you know, Buffett's out, all of these people,
yeah, coming
are still
back
there,
it's
you know
back.
Yeah, but the enthusiasm for the music that's your music, that's our music,
right,
and writing songs like Don't Close Your Eyes, which to local people, you know, it was just another kick song, but that, I guess when you go out and play that song in other places, it takes, my wife knew that song growing up in New Hampshire, right?
There you go. Yeah. Yeah. That was the one. That was one that catapulted us and got us out of the clubs and into the arenas.
That song and writing that song and being a part of that in that era when ballads and rock and roll, you're trying to be one thing, but
right,
it really was interesting how Hammerjack served many masters.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we always consider ourselves a hard rock, never a metal band, but a hard rock band. And in order to get on the radio, you basically had to have a power ballad. So We were lucky enough to come up with Don't Close Your Eyes, which did great for us. I mean, that record was doing well with Cold Blood and Blow My Fuse, but obviously it was Don't Close Your Eyes that put it over the top.
Well, we know you from, you know, Cold Shower and Itch and like, and you know, Cold Case of Heineken, like all of the old school stuff. But my first memory of seeing you, you opened for a very, very inebriated version of Aerosmith at the Capitol Center. Do you remember this?
Sure, I do.
Do you remember singing For Shame out on sort of a riser on the way?
They always threw me up in the air doing something stupid like that. So, yeah.
I think I have some great pictures of that if you need one.
That's all right. You keep it.
Tell me about the new music and writing songs and writing songs at this point and how it is different than, you know, I mean, some of the songs back in the 80s have a little double entendre. Some of them just skip the whole entendre all the way.
Yeah.
But I think you view the world differently when you get to be a little older, right?
Yeah, and, I do.
I listened to this music. It was sent over to me. I clicked the button and it popped up and it started playing.
Cool.
And I have this beautiful IMAX. Literally yesterday before I interviewed you, I said, I want to listen to it a little bit. The old music critic, the old Evening Sun guy and me get the CD and want to spin the new tunes. And I put it on and I just had it as sort of background music. And I got about four songs in and I really liked the fourth track. So whatever the fourth track was, you tell. But I looked it up because I wanted to note it. And I was listening to it and I'm like, man, this is like really has a what you can do during a pandemic that you used to have to go to New York and rent people and engineers and you'd fight with them and somebody had a coke habit and you got thrown out of the, like all that rock and roll stuff that made all these albums. It is amazing how crisp and the wisdom of 40 years of doing this makes it, right?
Well, I mean, the whole technology aspect has changed. I mean, everybody has Pro Tools in their own home studios. I did all the demos. I played everything on the demos by myself. And we used a lot of the guitars that I played. We used all the vocals that I sang on the record. So, and bringing in people like Bob Perry to play guitar and Dean Kramer to play guitar, they just were the icing on the cake. But it all started just, I had these songs and we wanted to record them and we had a great time doing it and I'm pretty proud of it.
Different than making albums in the 80s was like not, it was root canal, wasn't it? It was nice being a rock star and all that, but the actual process of making it, it's never been portrayed as fun by anyone, Jimmy Iovine, anybody.
And it was too expensive. I mean, we made our first album in New York, we made our second album in Miami, we made our third album in New York, Los Angeles, and it's like all we did was build up massive debt. Had we had the technology we have now, we actually might have made some money on those records because we never made a cent.
Steve Whiteman is our guest. He is Kicks and Funny Money and Solo Lee making music. And he'll be down at M3 kicking it off with a whole bunch of other bands. What do you listen to these days? I mean, I'm such a classic rock geek, you know. All of this stuff pops up. Your old stuff always pops up on my playlist because I love Blow My Fuse and I love all that stuff. But I new music, finding new music so important to keeping you feel young.
I agree. I get a lot of my recommendations listening to Eddie Trunk's podcast because he always lets you know when there's good new music, whether it's from the older bands or from a new band, like bands like Dirty Honey is really good. I love Hailstorm, Rival Sons, The Struts, all good young bands that are keeping rock and roll alive. So, and my daughter turns me on to stuff like Florence and the Machine. I like that stuff. I like a little bit of everything. I'm not just a rock and roll guy. I like a little bit of everything.
You sing in the shower?
No. I save my voice for shows.
That's it.
Yeah.
So for you, debuting new music at M3, or I mean, typical Kick stuff, but you have some new music. I mean, you wrote these songs, playing a couple of them?
No, I don't think the guy would want to do that. And the record hadn't even been out yet for people to get acquainted with it. So we're just going to stick to the tried and true and just give the Kicks fans what they want to hear.
Blow My Fuse, you got nothing to lose, right?
Yeah.
Steve, always a pleasure to visit with you. And, you know, I'm sorry you don't eat crab cakes, dude. And I mean, you told me, like, it would be tough to get a good crab cake in Hagerstown. I've been told that.
Yes, it would.
But what is something I should do out in your part of the world? What is something I need to see or visit?
That's a good question.
No, I've never been to Rocky Gap Park. I've never been to Antietam. There's just so many things like no offense on Hagerstown, but like I'm usually on my way to Pittsburgh for a football game.
Right.
And it's all I can do to stretch my legs in Breezewood. But, you know, I've often thought, like, I wonder what's over there in Hagerstown.
Yeah, most people will find Frederick more interesting. There's more better food, better restaurants. Hagerstown is just sort of stuck in the middle. And then you go past Hagerstown, and then you get up into Rocky Gap and Deep Creek Lake and all that up in Western Maryland. So Hagerstown isn't really known for much. It's just a quiet little town, and I like it because it's not too big. It's not too small. It's got everything you need. And, you know, I've been living here for about, hell, over 40 years I've been down here.
Well, my man Ethan Giffen is from Hagerstown. I don't know a bunch of people from Hagerstown. And Steve, I'm doing this crab cake tour, right? So like, I got the whole map of Maryland out. This is literally my hand drawn map, right? And you can see Hagerstown's like a little spot out on it, right? And I'm thinking, only person I know in Hagerstown, Steve. And I wasn't even sure you were there. I thought you might have been in Frederick or whatever.
Yeah.
Look, man, you sleep on it. Whatever I should be doing. If Anthony Bourdain came to Hagerstown, you would take him somewhere, Steve. You would. You would talk about rock and roll. And you would show him, like, where you wrote the itch. And you know what I mean? And where the van was with the case. Coke and Heineken. You would do all that. So I'm figuring between now and, I don't know, August 16th or whenever I'm in Hagerstown, you got to, like, tell me something I got to do. All right? I need Whiteman's recommendation. Even if it's not a crab cake, if it's a cheeseburger, a slice of pizza, I'm going to eat more than one meal, you know.
I'll give it some thought. I promise. Right.
I need Hagerstown recommendations. Thank you for helping me save my voice. Have other people, you still teaching people how to, like,
you
know, speak better?
When COVID hit, I stopped teaching. I thought it was going to be temporary, but being away from it after doing it for 25 years, I'm like, I think I've had enough of that. So I haven't gone back to it.
Well, I'll say this for you teaching me and me being one of many students of yours, dude, what you taught me, like, it's, I bring it with me a lifetime. The money I spent, the time I spent, you've helped me immensely over 25 years.
That's great to hear.
No, I mean, you were a lovely teacher and time well spent with you. And more than that, it was really, really helpful. And I have not had that problem. I mean, literally in this century. One of the other things I do, and it's a monitor issue for musicians, is having the levels right in your ears, you know,
absolutely.
Not bleeding yourself out and losing your voice. So
absolutely.
Thank you. Keep rocking. I won't ask you about those crazy drive-in shows where you're a million miles. We're done with all that.
No, they were great.
Loved it?
That thing in Frederick that we did, I thought the production that they pulled off, and nobody stayed in their cars. Everybody got out, and it was a lot of fun. We enjoyed them.
It looked unique and available.
It
didn't look like me and you at the Shark Club in Vegas in the night, you know? Didn't look like you and Hammer Jacks back in the
day. No,
you know, like,
I mean,
I want to touch my rock stars.
You had to do what you had to do. So, I mean, for what it was, they made it really, I thought they made it visually great.
And I saw all, again, how do you think I know about these things? Everybody I know was there with their camera showing me what it looked like. Johnny played as well. I talked to him about it. And I think everybody says, yeah, it was unique. It was good. It was like going to a football game with nobody. I don't want to do it again. You know, like, it was unique. It was cool. But let's get back to M3. Let's get back to Merriweather. Yeah. Get back out on the lawn.
But it was okay. Let me tell the people what the name of the record is.
Sure, right? Please do.
It's just Steve Whiteman, and I got my little stick man in the middle of it, and it's called You're Welcome, which is a bit that I've been doing from stage for about 5 years. When I say thank you after a song, I expect the crowd to yell back in unison, you're welcome. So I thought that'd be a perfect title for the record.
Steve, are you going to perform these songs at any point? Or you know?
I mean, Kix is doing a lot of makeup shows. So if we ever get some downtime, we did talk about Dean and Bob and Jimmy and Brad, talked about if we could get together, go out and play a couple shows and share these songs with some people after they get acquainted with it. Yeah, that's a possibility.
Well, how busy are you as a working band? As you said, you got shows to make up. I mean, I've looked at some of the tour schedules, and I was talking to the Cheap Trick guys about this and the whole family. I'm like, the bands that are touring, it's very aggressive right now, right? Like, I mean, bands that are going out, they've been waiting a long time, and they're stacking dates and stacking shows, and clubs want you, you know, literally.
Exactly. And the people were coming out in droves. So, I mean, everybody was ready to get out of their house and come out and rock and roll. So, yeah, we got a ton of dates that we're making up.
People want to find the record. What's the best way? I mean, you can just probably Google Steve Whiteman new album, but like, what is the preferred way that they compensate you and make this thing official?
Actually, if you go to Right Rock, RIGHTROCK, rightrocksportswear.com, and you type in Kix, Steve, you're welcome. the you can pre-order it now. So it's brightrocksportswear.com.
All right. We're going to send everybody out there. I'll tweet that out as well on the social media side.
Cool.
Dude, thank you. You know, it's just always fun to visit with you. The anti-rock star. Maybe it's the Hagerstown in you or the Dundalk in me. And I am embarrassed that I don't have you on a little bit more often. But and I won't push you on the shellfish. Believe me, I need you on stage upright. All right.
Absolutely.
Steve, good luck with the new gig and the new album. And we'll see you M3 next week for sure.
Sounds great.
Doing what I like to say, shaking his ass on the stage, what God meant for Steve Whiteman to be doing, and singing Kick songs in the Kicks band, the Baltimore Beatles. Always good to visit with him. Get back out, support local music. I'm wearing my Stone Horses shirt.
Hell yeah.
I've had the people from Wrecker on. I've had people all over town. My buddy Eddie Lauer and Jason Seamer were Bad With Names out rocking. So please get out, whoever the artist is, wherever the music is. Yep. Crack the Sky, Mahoney Brothers, Dean Crawford, all playing over at Heritage Fair. We're going to get out and have a great summer of music to celebrate life and post-pandemic. I'm Nestor. Absolutely. We are WNST, AM 1570, Towson, Baltimore. We never stop talking to rock stars whenever they make time for us. And Baltimore Positive with Steve Whiteman.